Half-a-day students, I am Governor Lou Leon Guerrero. You all have been through a year of big changes. We've had to adapt and make big changes to keep our families and our island safe. But with change comes opportunity and a chance to try new things like PBS University. While Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio and I will continue to do our part to keep our island safe, you students have a part to play as well. Your part is to keep learning and to keep up with your lessons. That's why I am happy to see you here ready to learn with PBS University. PBS University is a way to bring a continuous educational curriculum to you while you stay safe at home during this time. To help you keep up with your studies, we asked our friends at PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education to put together this episode. Thank you for doing your part and have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education in conjunction with public school teachers. These lessons are created to provide both parents and students with a unique educational experience while helping students to continue learning at home. PBS University, next on PBS Guam.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Come along, let's sing a song, we'll have a great adventure. We'll have a great adventure.
Numbers,
letters,
science, things, all that we can do. Help you deal with how you feel. Share with us too.
It's super cool and just like school.
Our awesome learning adventures. So grab a friend, the fun will end. Our awesome learning adventures. Awesome learning adventures.
Ni hao, boys and girls. That's how you say hello in Chinese. My name is Mrs. Martin, and I will be your first and second grade teacher for literacy. By now, I truly believe that you have mastered consonant digraphs and vowel digraphs. So can you tell me what these are?
Two letters together and they make a new sound.
That's right. When you put two letters together, they make new sounds. Or sometimes you might have three letters that come together. And usually these are for consonants. Before we begin today's episode, I wanted to recap and use the song that I sang last time about digraphs. And this time, I wanted to see if you can sing along with me. Do you think you can sing along with me today? Great! Hit it!
When I use digraphs, put consonants or vowels together, they make a new sound. The first vowel, please do, just say its name.
A-I-A-Y,
then make the A sound. The first vowel, please do, just say its name. E-E-E-N-A, they make the E sound.
Once upon a time, there was a pea. He went out to sea. He wanted to see all that he could. Never thought he'd see a bee. During the voyage, he drank some tea. He practiced lots of thank you and please. He watched the sun rise and set. He plays, dances, sings, and sleeps.
When I use digraphs to put consonants or vowels together, they make a new sound. The first vowel, please, you just say its name.
A-I-A-Y,
to make the A sound. The first vowel, please, you just say its name. E-E-E-N-A, they make the E sound.
As a review for Vowel Digraphs, I wanted to read you a story. And so I'm going to task you to use your looking eyes to find any words that have the vowel digraphs A, E, or E. I will be reading you a book called If Big Can, I Can by Beth Shoshin and Petra Brown. I'm so excited for this book today, and I hope you are too. If you're ready, I'm ready. Let's hop in a book. If Big Can, I Can by Beth Shoshin and Petra Brown. If Big can run, then I can run. Though not as fast, I'm only small. If Big can jump, then I can jump. And Big leaps long, long, long away.
Leaps and away.
That's right. Good looking. Let's keep looking. If Big can swing, then I can swing. As Big swings high into the sky, I'll get there too, one day I'm sure.
Day.
Yes, Day also has one of the digraphs we've been working on. If Big can climb, then I can climb. It's just I have to take my time to get to all the places Big can climb to with one stretch. If Big can see, then I can saw. Up, up I go into the air. I never thought I'd get so high, but now that Big is on the ground, how will I get down? It's pretty silly, isn't it?
Sea and air.
Good looking. If Big can play, then I can play. Deep in the sand, Big digs a hole. But if I fell in, I'd be stuck, and then I'd have to yell and shout for Big to come and pull me out. I see too, do you?
Yes, play and deep.
That's correct. But what if Big can't get in places only I can squeeze inside?
Squeeze.
That's right, squeeze. I'd find the treasures, rule the roost, be number one. And Big would know I'm having fun.
What about treasure?
That's right. Treasures also has the EA digraph that we've been working on. But we pronounce it a little bit differently in this word. And that's okay. Here, I can swing into the air, running fast and leaping long, and stretch to climb and soaring high into the air and digging deep, but Big's not there. Let me see how many I can count. Three, I spot three.
Air, leaping, and deep.
That's correct, air, leaping, and deep. Good looking. I'm all alone, and that's no fun. Whatever Big can, and whatever I can, we can together. The end. Well, boys and girls, CSU for joining me today. And that's how you say thank you in Chinese, by the way. I hope you had lots of fun just like I did. I will see you next time. Take care and be kind.
Mabuhay, mathematicians! Mabuhay is how we say hello in Tagalog. Welcome to PBS University, first through second grade math. My name is Mr. Nicholas, and I'm so excited that you're joining me today. Friends, do you remember what we talked about last week? Right, we talked about shapes, 2D shapes and 3D shapes. Today, we are going to be exploring an insect who uses shapes in a very important way. I'm going to give you some hints, and I want to know if you can guess this insect. Are you ready to begin? Awesome, let's start.
These insects play an important role in pollination and create a sticky, sweet treat in their home.
Did you guess bees? You are absolutely correct.
I'm here with beekeepers from the Guam Beekeeper Association, and I'm here with beekeeper Miss Olympia. Miss Olympia, can you tell our friends what is the Guam Beekeepers Association?
Well, yes, I'm happy to tell you the Guam Beekeepers Association is a group of beekeepers that come together to learn more about beekeeping, to keep bees safe, and to provide honey to the people of Guam.
Honey sounds delicious. I love to have honey on my toast. Yum! Thank you so much for having honey on island. What do beekeepers do here on island?
So, one of the most important things we do is we give homes to bees that are just living in the trees. If a typhoon comes, their honeycomb is knocked right out of that tree. But if they have a hive to live in, it's much safer for them. Also, they can't be attacked by the greater banded hornet, which is about this big. And the bee's only this big.
Oh my goodness.
And so they can really just kill a lot of bees. So we, as beekeepers, keep them safe in our hives, and we talk to them, and we learn from the bees because they have so much to teach us about living in community, about sharing, about enough maulik, just like on Guam. And so it's a pleasure to be a beekeeper and work with the bees.
Miss Olympia, that is amazing. Would you guys like to see the home that the beekeepers have the bees stay in? Awesome, follow us.
Let's go.
So I'm standing here in front of the beehive, and I have a question for Miss Olympia. Miss Olympia, can you tell us how shapes are important to the bees?
I am so glad you asked that question. I would love to tell you. Now, if you look here on the frame, you can see a six-sided shape. That's a hexagon. And the bees make that shape because it's the strongest shape in the world. So they make a little circle. They put their wax. The wax comes out of their bellies, out of their abdomen, the front, and then they take it in their mouth, they chew it around, and then they place it right where they want it, and they stick it all together. Starts out round, but then ends up six-sided as they push it around and gravity takes it. This is where they lay their eggs. They want a nice, strong space for their eggs, and where the babies are born, and where they put their honey.
Thank you so much for telling us about how shapes are important to bees. Friends, what was the name of that shape that the bees use? Right, a hexagon.
Wow, working with the bees was a really special experience. I do have to admit though, that when I first got there, I was pretty nervous and I was actually pretty scared to be so close to the bees. I was really nervous about being stung. It was important that I was with experienced beekeepers, and they taught me a little bit more about the bees. Remember, you should not touch any bees without an experienced beekeeper assistant. Today, I'm going to be reading you guys a special book. It's called The Thing About Bees, a love letter written by Shabazz Larkin. Here's the thing about bees. Sometimes bees can be a bit rude. They fly in your face and prance on your food. They buzz in the bushes and buzz in your ear. They sneak up behind you and fill you with fear. And worst of all, they do this thing called sting. Ouch! We may want bees gone because their sting hurts, but if they were all gone, it would hurt much worse. Without bees, there would be no more picnics with watermelon. There'd be no more smoothies with mango. There'd be no more strawberries for shortcakes and no more avocados for tacos. There'd be no apples, which means no more pie. No more cucumbers, which means no more pickles. No more blueberries and raspberries for pancakes or sweet cherries for drizzle. Because some foods won't grow without bees to help them along. In a way, bees are just like you. You buzz in the bushes and buzz in my ear. You sneak up behind me and fill me with fear. You fly in my face and prance on my food. You even sting when you're in a bad mood. But I never stop loving you. You're my sweet cherry, the apple pie of my eye. You're my cucumber pickle, my bumblebee in the sky. You're my cold watermelon at a picnic in the park. You're the avocados on my tacos. You're my strawberry heart. Without those little buzzers, the world wouldn't know what to do. That's the thing about bees. We need them just as much as we need you. All right, friends. It was so great of you to join me today. I look forward to seeing you next week. Bye! Boys and girls, welcome back to PBS University. Miss Valencia here, your first and second grade science teacher. Everyone and almost everything goes through changes and stages. This is known as a life cycle. As human beings, we start off as tiny babies and then we grow up to be nice, strong adults. In a previous lesson, we learned about the life cycle of a plant, that's right. Do you remember the life cycle of a plant? What do they start off as? Correct, they start off as tiny seeds and then within time, they will grow to become a tree. Can you think of any other living things that go through changes and stages? Do you guys hear that? What's that? It is a bee buzzing. In fact, today's lesson is going to be about the life cycle of a bee. To help us with this lesson, I went ahead and took a trip to the University of Guam GDOE Research and Education Center with a few teachers from PBS University. Here, we met up with two of our very own beekeepers, Mr. Chris Rosario and Miss Olympia Terrell.
On the left is Miss Olympia. And in the middle, it's Mr. Chris. They're both professional beekeepers here on Guam. Do you all know who that guy is on the right side? Yeah, it's Mr. Ochoco. Say hi.
So, this is what happens. In a colony, there can only be one queen bee. And everyone else, well, they're worker bees. Check it out. Can you spot the queen bee here in this video? It was quite challenging for us to look for her, but with the help from Mr. Chris and Miss Olympia, we were able to spot her. She's the one with the most slender abdomen. Did you know that the queen bee lays an egg every 2 minutes? Okay, moving on. So the queen has just laid her egg. Now the worker bees will come in to take care of that egg. Where does the queen go? Well, she has to go and do some queenly things. Okay, back to the worker bees. So the worker bees take care of the egg. And within 3 days, the egg will hatch into a larva. And then the worker bees are going to think,
it's time to give this larva some honey. That way it can eat it.
Okay, so after the larval stage, we get the pupa. Pupa is the third stage for the life cycle of a honeybee, particularly Apis mellifera, or the European honeybee. Take a look at this video. Here we can see Mr. Chris carefully opening up one of the cells. What's that white thing underneath? That's right, it's the pupa. Remember, Mr. Chris is a professional at this and he knows how to handle bees. So please, boys and girls, do not try this at home. What do you observe the worker bees do once Mr. Chris opens up the cell. That's right, they're swarming back to that area to make sure that the little baby bee does not get disturbed. Maybe they're thinking,
"Hey, Mr. Beekeeper, don't ruin the work that we have just did. Now we have to cover it back up."
Okay, so after the pupa stage, we get the last stage, the fourth one, for the life cycle of a bee. That's right, we get an adult bee. Once we have an adult bee, the bee will go out there where he or she will do the work that honeybees are supposed to do.
Okay, that was a lot of information on honeybees. Let's have a quick review. How many stages are in a honeybee life cycle? Is it 1, 2, 3, or 4? If you guessed 4, give yourself a pat on the back because you are correct. What are the 4 stages for the honeybee life cycle? Remember, first, the queen must lay the egg. And then the egg will hatch into a larva. Third, the larva then becomes a pupa. And lastly, the pupa finally grows into an adult honeybee. Last question. How many queen bees are in one colony? 1, 2, 3, or 4? If you guessed 1, I think you deserve some sweet honey because you are correct.
Okay, boys and girls, you all did such a great job at listening today, but I want you all to remember that only professional beekeepers are to handle bees. So if you see a beehive, be sure to stay calm and stay away. And then give Mr. Chris Rosario a call at the numbers you see here on the screen. All right, boys and girls, go ahead and kiss your brains. Because you all did such an excellent job at listening today, I hope you enjoyed our lesson on the life cycle of a bee. It's time to buzz away. Bye.
Holiday students, welcome to PBS University. My name is John Fernandez, and I'm the superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. These PBS University lessons are made to help you to continue learning. The teachers here prepared fun lessons on science, character education, math, English, and more, and they made it for you, the students of Guam. We're very grateful to them for their instruction. We're also thankful for you students, parents, and guardians who are watching. Remember, stay safe and healthy, and we'll see you soon in the next school year. Thank you.
Hola, 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 guacamole. Hola, hola, I mix you oh so slowly. Hola, hola, I love you more than bologna. Hola, friends. It's Mrs. Pegarito, your first and second grade social studies teacher. Did you know that hola is how we say hello in Spanish? I was just making a bowl of guacamole. Do you know what the main ingredient in guacamole is? It's avocados. Oh, guacamole is also a staple dish in Mexico. And in Mexico, they also say hola, because they speak Spanish. Hey, I was thinking maybe I should take some of this guacamole and maybe some avocados and bring some to my neighbors. I have a big avocado tree outside. Would you like to come with me and help me pick some avocados?
awesome! Let's go!
Here's my avocado tree.
Here are our learning goals. I can explain rights, rules, and laws.
Get a whole bunch of avocados. I think we have a lot to share with our neighbors. You know, being a good neighbor makes me feel so special. That's because being a good neighbor means that you are a part of a community. I love that word, community. Can you say it with me? Community.
Some communities are big and some are small. In every community, people have rights. Rights are special things that people are allowed to do, but it doesn't allow them to do whatever they want to do. They must follow rules and laws.
For example, my neighbors can't just come and pick avocados off my tree. That'll make me really sad because I worked really hard to grow my tree. Then I won't have any avocados to share with my neighbors. But they can ask and I can give it to them.
That is a law.
A rule, however, is something that you follow in order to keep you and others safe. Let's play a game. See if you can identify these types of rules. What are some rules you follow in school? We have rules in school to keep us safe. What rule does this look like? What are the children wearing on their face? Did you say mask? That's right. That's one rule that protects us from getting sick. Wear your mask in school and in public places. Classrooms have rules. For example, you may see this rule in school. What rule does this look like? Did you say raise your hand? Correct! We have to raise our hand for permission to speak. Or you may have to keep your microphones on mute during online class. That's a rule that makes it fair for everyone to have a turn to speak or listen to their teacher. Great job, everyone! You guys are awesome! You know your rules in school. What about this rule? What are the children doing here? Did you say walking? Right! You have to walk in school. It is not safe to run in the hallways. Someone can get really hurt. Great job, boys and girls! Now let's talk about laws. A law is a rule that everyone in the community must obey. Our government leaders make rules for everyone in the community to follow. These rules are called laws. You might see police officers enforcing laws in our community. They're the good guys that are trying to keep everyone safe. Laws can change over time. For example, a long time ago, there was a law that said women cannot vote.
That law changed. Now, women can vote. A long time ago, they didn't have cars or automobiles, and people rode in something that looked like this. Now there are cars and automobiles all over the place. And that's why we need traffic laws. So it's a law you have to buckle up, wear your seatbelt, and follow the traffic signs. Well, boys and girls, I hope you had fun today learning about rights, rules, and laws. And now it's time to be a good citizen of our community and deliver these avocados to our neighbor. Come on, let's go.
Happy day and buongiorno, boys and girls, and welcome back to PBS University Guam. My name is Mrs. Estella, and today I'm going to be your character education teacher for first and second grade. I'm very excited for today's lesson, but before we begin, did you know buongiorno means good morning in Italian? Well, if you didn't know, now you know. Mrs. Stella simply loves Italian cuisine. Anything pasta, fettuccine, spaghetti, ravioli, macaroni, lasagna. Oh, I'm making Mrs. Stella hungry just talking about it. But yes, I love Italian food. And buongiorno means good morning in Italian. So for today's lesson, we're going to talk about having the courage to try something new, which means to do something that has never been done before. Yes, my helpers and Mrs. Estella are going to try some new things, and maybe you can try some new things too over the summer. So here's what we did, or here is what we're going to do. Let's check it out. We're going on an adventure.
Rescue boats that go out and save lives if something happens in the ocean. Bye, rescue boats. Look at this awesome marina. Boys and girls, Mrs. Stella here at this rock and rail horse ranch up in Chico. Check out all these beautiful creatures.
There you go.
Good job. Now you're gonna hold. Woo!
Well, I can't believe how grown up you are, because you used to be mommy's baby. Just hold on tight.
course.
Now that was awesome sauce. I don't know about you, but even just to catch one fish, even if it wasn't a lot, one fish is better than no fish. That was so exciting. We got to catch a fish with my dad, Mr. James, one of the best fishermen on Guam. The biggest fish my dad has ever caught was a 942-pound marlin. I'm not kidding. Here's a picture. Check this out. Yes, that's my dad who caught a 942-pound marlin. Wow, that is amazing. And then just to see my helpers, my daughters, try riding a horse for the very first time at the Rock and Rail Horse Ranch up in Jigo, now that made me so proud. And I got to see and pet those beautiful horses, those beautiful creatures in person. You can try it too. I hope, boys and girls, over the summer that you will have the courage to try new things too. It's about that time for Mrs. Stella to go, but don't you worry, Chicken Curry. I'll see you again soon. So stay safe, and when you try something new, be sure to always check with an adult that it's safe. I'll see you when I see you. Adios! So long, farewell, I'll see you when I see you. Goodbye.
My Dickie Key friends, welcome back to PBS University. I'm Senora Loretta, and this is Pina, and this is Benita Babui. Half a day, Rana Nim, and Nyakwe means hello in Chamorro, Chukis, and Marshallese. Today, we're going to be talking about things of the house, things in the house, and today, Pina and Benita Babui are going to help me. Pina and Benita Babui were drawn a few years ago. I drew these two characters for a storybook, and they were my inspiration for two little girls. And so you're going to see them digitally, and my friend Rudy really helped me create them. So they're going to help us today, and it's going to be really exciting and really fun.
Hi there, and welcome again. Isn't it so cool how we look?
Yeah, we were first made out of paper, and now we look like cartoon characters.
Pina, let's show our friends some things that we may use in a house.
Bonita, baby, what kind of things?
Oh, Pina, let's show our PBS University friends simple things like furniture, appliances, or objects that we may use daily in a house in Chamorro.
That sounds like a great idea. Are you ready, PBS University friends?
This first picture I want to show is a picture of a refrigerator.
Refrigerator? A refrigerator is a home appliance. Benita Babui, let's share with our friends how to say refrigerator in Chamorro.
That sounds like a great idea, Pina. Are you ready, friends? Refrigerator. Kahun ice. Kahun ice. A refrigerator is a machine used for keeping things cold. It is sometimes called a fridge or an ice box. Most cajon ice also has a smaller compartment to freeze foods like ice cream and meats.
Yummy! Friends, let's say refrigerator together in Chamorro. Cajon ice! Cajon ice!
Gough, Malik, Pina, and PBS University friends. This is a dining table. I like it when Senora Loretta makes tasty chamorro dishes and we sit around the table and eat together.
Ooh, yes! This is one of my favorite things in a house. I like it when we all sit together and enjoy a simple meal together or a tasty treat. Bonita Babui, how do you say dining table in Chamorro?
Dining table is lamasan fanyututan. Lamasan fanyututan. Remember, our last lesson we used fanyututan, which is dining room. La mesa means table. Let's add both words together to say dining table. La mesa en fanututen. Try it out.
La mesa en fanututen. La mesa en fanututen.
Gov, Malik, Pina, and friends. Check out this photo. It's one of my favorite furniture in a house. I like to sit and relax on a couch and watch my PBS University shows on TV.
Me too! I like to sit and relax and watch TV too on a couch.
Are you ready, friends? I'm going to share with you how to say couch in Chamorro. Sofa, sofa.
PBS friends, sit on your couch and let's say this word together in Chamorro. Ready? Sofa, sofa.
Yay, good job, everyone. Our next Chamorro word is shower or bathtub. Banyo, banyo, bathtub.
So, shower or bathtub is banyo?
Yes, Pina. So let's go over the words you all learned today.
Yay, this will help us remember the words in Chamorro.
Are you ready, friends? The first word I shared with you is a place where we store food to make things cold. Refrigerator. Kahun ice. Kahun ice. The next word is a type of furniture where we sit down and eat tasty foods.
Ooh, like ice cream?
Yes, or tasty meals. Dining table. La mesa en fanututen. La mesa en fanututen. The next word is another furniture where you can sit and relax and watch TV. Sofa. Sofa. Couch. And our last word is a place in a house where you can take a shower or bath. Banyo. Banyo. Friends, thank you for helping us out. Try practicing daily with these Chamorro words. Now let's join Senora Loretta with our adios song. Okay, boys and girls, here's a short Chamorro jingle about saying goodbye until next time.
Adios, este keep us adios.
Adios.
Adios, este keep us adios.
Adios.
Adios, este keep us adios. Adios, este keep us adios. Este keep us adios.
Day kids, this is another fast fun fact for Mr. Ernesto Choco. And we're also still on bees. Why? Because bees are so beautiful and they've got so many wonderful things that they do for the world. One of them is the honey that they make. Did you know that honey is actually medicinal? Yeah, you can use it like medication. How? Let's talk to honey bee queen herself, Miss Olympia Zarrell.
Well, I don't know about you, but I like to sing.
You like to sing?
And when my throat gets a little bit sore, mm-hmm. and I need to sing, I just make some honey tea.
honey tea.
Yes.
That's actually from your honeycomb.
Yes.
Let's look at the honeycomb.
Check it out.
Cool.
Yeah.
And I'm also a singer myself. I sing opera. Just kidding. No, I'm not kidding. I am actually an opera singer.
He really does. Okay. Hi G.
Hi G. Oh! I think the bees would get freaked out.
Oh yeah,
but,
we should do a high bee then.
We just high bee, like or high five. But let's make it a bee, like a bee in high sign language. High bee.
Yeah, cool.
There we go. And there goes the honeycomb.
There goes the honeycomb.
So the thing that we can use honey for is our throat. So if we're singing and we have a sore throat, we can drink tea with honey. And it will help clear our throat.
Absolutely.
And it will also help heal our throats.
Absolutely.
Right? And I know Mr. Chris over here said that we could also use it for wounds.
That's right.
Why?
Because the honey is used as antibacterial and antifungal, which means when the bacteria falls into the honey, that the bacteria suffocates.
Oh my gosh, wow, what an interesting way to put it, Mr. Chris.
That's what it does.
But that's what it does.
And so the bacteria no longer survive, and then the honey takes over. So wow. And so the honey is used to cover your wounds if you have a cut.
And it's antiseptic.
And it's antiseptic, correct.
Yes. Not Uncle Septic.
Not Uncle Septic.
Antiseptic. Like my aunties in Jigunang, they always take care of me like the honey.
Yeah.
They give me tonight.
Better than the uncles, right?
Yeah, the uncles, they don't give me stuff, just the aunties. But anyway, so it's antiseptic and it can help heal your wounds. So, that's another fast fun fact about bees with me, Mr. Hezochoko, Mr. Chris over here, and Miss Queen Bee, Olympia Terrell. Bye everybody, have a great day.
Today, students, I'm Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. For more than a year now, you all have continued to wash your hands and watch your distance from others, and you've done a really great job wearing your masks. We know your parents and guardians have helped you to make these changes to keep yourself and your community safe. As Governor Leon Guerrero said, we are happy you are here. We want you to continue to learn and sharpen your skills with the help of PBS University. This program is the result of a collaborative effort. We couldn't do it alone. I'd like to thank the teachers and support staff of the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam for their work and their commitment to our students. I'd also like to thank you, students, for participating at home. To your parents, I'd like to thank you for taking an active role in your child's education. We are all eager to return to a time when all of us can share and study together in person. Until then, we hope you learned something new from this PBS University instruction.